Hello, everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you may be in the world today. Thank you for joining us for our webinar, Better Together, Apache Cassandra and Apache Kafka. My name is Mike Ledesma, and I'll be your moderator for today's webinar. Before I introduce today's speakers, I wanted to go through a few quick housekeeping items. Everyone is muted and will remain so for the duration of the presentation to avoid any background noise. If you have any technical issues, please attempt to refresh your browser. In addition, if you have any questions throughout the presentation, please submit them via the Q&A widget, which will be at the bottom of your screen. We will take all questions during the latter portion of the presentation, but please submit them throughout. And finally, you can find resources to today's topic on the left side of your screen, which we invite you to download and explore. And with that, I'd like to introduce you to our two speakers for today. Cedric Ludenbin. Cedric is the developer advocate manager at DataStax, where he's able to share his passions about development and distributed architectures. With several positions as developer, technical architect, and pre-sales, he has a strong background in integration middleware and has had multiple opportunities to empower his customers to build cutting-edge distributed applications. In 2013, he created his own open-source framework and still actively maintains it. He is also contributing to JHipster framework and is very active in the Cassandra community in EMEA. Our second speaker, Jeff Carpenter, is the Director of Developer Advocacy at DataStax, where he leverages his background in system architecture, microservices, and Apache Cassandra to help empower developers and operators and operations engineers build distributed systems that are scalable, reliable, and secure. Jeff has worked on projects ranging from complex battle planning systems in an austere network environment to a cloud-based hotel reservation system, and is the author of Cassandra, the Definitive Guide, Second Edition. So with that, Jeff, I'd like to hand it off to you. You can take it away from here.
Wonderful. Thanks, everyone, for joining us today. As Michael said, you know, wherever you are in the world, whatever time of day it is, we appreciate your time. And I'm looking forward to talking with you and answering your questions. So let's dive into it. The agenda for this hour is we're going to do a quick introduction to these two technologies, Apache Cassandra and Apache Kafka. We're going to talk together about some ways in which these two technologies are combined together frequently. We're going to take a deep dive specifically on the DataStax Kafka connector, looking into one of those patterns in some depth. And Cedric's going to really give some great details on the connector and then a demonstration on how it's used, some of the configuration options, and getting things set up and configured and getting that data flowing. So that'll be exciting. And we also have a few resources to share with you, which we'll provide at the end about where you can go to learn more, some example code that you can download and run yourself. So, and of course, we'll be looking to answer your questions as they roll in. So thank you, Michael, for the great job introducing us. If you want to see just a little bit information about Cedric and I, about you know, some of our contact information, if you want to reach out to us directly, you can find that in here, you know, on Twitter or LinkedIn, for example. And you can see some of our areas of interest that Michael shared with you already. So first of all, I want to make sure that we have a level playing field for everyone coming into this. I don't know how much each of you individually know about Cassandra and Kafka, and so I'm just going to highlight a few top-level things just to level set for us. And there's a little bit of a method here that you'll see in a minute. So first of all, Apache Cassandra, this is a project that was developed at Facebook originally for address book kind of functionality. They ended up moving on from that fairly quickly and deciding to open source the project. What's really interesting is that through Facebook having acquired Instagram several years back, Instagram were heavy Cassandra users. So things kind of came full circle with Cassandra coming back into heavy use at Facebook, which is kind of a fun anecdote. But they did donate it, open source it. It became a top-level Apache project in 2010. The data model, the most helpful term that we use to describe Cassandra as an operational database is that it is a partitioned row store. So it's obviously one of these NoSQL or non-relational kind of databases, although it does have the Cassandra query language that it uses, which is, you know, similar to SQL. So some of the architectural characteristics that we know and love about Cassandra is that it's a distributed, decentralized architecture. There is no single point of failure. Every node is a peer. This means that Cassandra can survive the loss of any particular node quite easily, and those can be replaced. You can elastically scale your Cassandra clusters by adding more nodes to them to handle additional read and or write load on your cluster. So Cassandra scales very easily on commodity hardware, and that's one of the things that's made it very attractive to people that have larger and larger data sets. It has the attribute that we call tunable consistency, in which it does not provide full ACID level transactions that you might be accustomed to from a relational background, but it does provide some knobs that you can twist. You can get more consistency on your reads and writes where you need it through adjusting attributes called consistency level, and also there is a lightweight transaction mechanism that you can use. So there are ways, people like to say that Cassandra is eventually consistent, and I say, well, if you use the defaults, then that's true, but there are ways that you can get more consistency in cases that you need it. So those are just some of the highlights of Cassandra. Now let's look, kind of turn our gaze over toward Kafka. So Kafka was developed at LinkedIn. It became a top-level Apache project not too long, just a couple years after Cassandra did. And we like to describe Kafka as a distributed streaming platform. So whereas Cassandra would be a distributed database and a distributed OLTP database, Kafka is a distributed streaming platform. It's most frequently used. Kind of the top two buckets of use cases are real-time data pipelines and streaming applications. So a lot of times people are using Kafka to move data around between systems, and then also to capture data as it moves through the system and perform operations on that in a streaming sense. Kafka has a lot of similar attributes about its architecture to Cassandra. So it is also horizontally scalable through adding additional nodes. It's also high performance. You can scale the performance of your Kafka cluster by adding capacity to it. It also supports some of those attributes of high availability and fault tolerance through loss of nodes. Some of the details of how that is achieved are slightly different under the hood, but at a high level, what you need to know about both of these technologies as a consumer of them is that they have mechanisms built into them to be highly scalable and to be high availability. There are some interesting aspects of Kafka as a how the integrations of related technologies work in Kafka. So we'll talk a little bit about the Kafka streams and what that's all about, just at a kind of a quick level. And then also we will spend a little bit more time and focus on the Kafka Connect framework, which is how adjacent technologies and data sources and syncs are integrated with Kafka. So that's going to be a major focus of our conversation today. So just a few of these terminology and concepts that we have in the Kafka world, just so that you know, a lot of our audience from a DataStax perspective will have more familiarity with some of the concepts of Cassandra, but I wanted to make sure that we introduce these Kafka terms just so that we're all on the same page. So in Kafka, the unit of what we're talking about in terms of communication between producers and consumers of data are these things called topics, which are collections of key value pairs. So topics are append only. We are not replacing values within a topic. We're creating new messages on these topics and appending them. So it is a kind of a log structured data structure. Now these topics, because they have a kind of a key value semantics to them, they can be partitioned in terms of the keys. That means they can, this is how Kafka scales and through adding multiple nodes in Kafka terminology sorry, the Kafka brokers. Apologies for the flipping on the slides back and forth. So you have multiple Kafka brokers and partition the contents of a topic over them according to the key. And then the producers publish or data into these topics, which can then be consumed by one or more consumers. And one of the nice properties of Kafka is that each consumer can maintain its own separate offset into this ordered stream of data within a topic. Data can persist in a topic for as long as you want, or you know, you can configure that according to your available storage. Some other concepts here, we can have the idea of something that is a both a producer and a consumer of Kafka topics through something that's known as the streams, or Kafka Streams API. So oftentimes what a streams application will do will be to consume data from one or more topics and then use other data or you know, perform some kind of transformation to combine data from those sources. Maybe it's a join, or maybe it's embellishing with data from another source and then writing out data to a new topic. And if you've heard of the KSQL or Kafka SQL, Kafka query language, this is the query language that's used by many stream applications, which is a very nice familiar API that makes interacting with streams very easy to do. So as I mentioned, these Kafka topics are provided by one or more brokers that are organized together in a cluster. And what I've shown here on the right is just kind of some conceptual diagrams of what's involved in the Kafka Connect framework. So you can think of Kafka as forming somewhat of that message fabric or the equivalent of a message bus that you might have been familiar in previous service-oriented architectures, but it's you know, it's considerably more powerful than some of those message brokers that we were using back in the day. But it can be a conduit for moving data between you know, legacy relational databases, current apps that we have, some other things, Elasticsearch, Cassandra. You get the idea of being able to move data around between different sources and sinks, and that's actually that concept that's shown at that picture on the bottom is within the Kafka Connect framework that Cedric will explain in more detail. We have data sources that are, we have connectors that are helping to get data from data sources into our Kafka cluster, and then we have sinks that plug into that Connect framework that are able to write data out to other sources, for example, Cassandra that we'll be talking about today. So there has been some conversation that I've seen back and forth about whether Cassandra and Kafka are competing technologies or you know, use one or the other. I will say that in the vast majority of cases, they really are doing different things. Well, yes, you can use Kafka for data storage, but oftentimes when you have any sort of sophistication in your needs of your data that's being stored, like for example, you want to do queries on it over time or to be able to do search queries on it, you're gonna need to have a backing database. You know, Kafka is not really great or very suitable for any doing sort of sophisticated searches over the contents of your data. So if you only need it as a queue and if you only need to access it in sequential order, then of course a Kafka topic is perfectly acceptable for that. Most often, though, what we see is these two technologies being used in combination with each other, where Cassandra is being used as it was designed as an operational data store, and Kafka being used as part of data pipelines and moving data around between systems. So, a lot of companies are using both of these technologies in combination. What's the reason for that? One of the reasons that makes them so compatible is that there are a lot of architectural similarities underpinning them. So, you know, they're both distributed systems designed on solid distributed system principles. So that includes these ideas of partitioning data across multiple nodes or replicas or brokers in the Kafka terminology. They both use hashing algorithms based on keys in order to know which of these nodes or brokers and clusters know where the data lives. They also use replication, which is a principle of storing multiple copies of data so that you can survive a loss of any of the nodes in a cluster. They're both great at multi-data center or even multi-cloud kind of deployments. So they are cloud agnostic. They don't care whether you have data centers that are running in your own private cloud or various public clouds. And so for that reason, that's a very popular attribute of both of these technologies that makes them very useful. They both use a log structured kind of append-only storage model, which is interesting to me because I like understanding how databases work underneath the hood. Maybe not so important from a consumption perspective, but just knowing that a lot of the same architectural principles went into making these things scalable. They also have a principle in which they can help the tools themselves can help manage your data retention in terms of time to live and how long your data is kept around. Both Cassandra and Kafka have principles of being able to expire older data out of the system rather than you as a client application having to delete data yourself. So those are all really nice features. And I think that the fact that both of these technologies have a lot of similar architectural characteristics is a big factor in why they are used together. So I would say my advice, use Cassandra for high volume, write intensive data storage and workloads at high scale. Cassandra makes a great system of record for your data. And if you are a DataStax Enterprise customer, you'll have additional capabilities on top of that core database for a lot of advanced searching options. I'm not saying it's Elasticsearch, but I'm saying that in terms of having an integrated search capability with your database, that's a perfect solution that's part of DataStax Enterprise with our DSC search. So when to use Kafka is when you have streaming data that you need to get to and from services and legacy data sources. And when you want to build data pipelines to act upon changes in data from multiple sources to do joins or that sort of thing. So I would say use the right technology for the right part of your use case. Maybe Cassandra is like chocolate and Kafka is like peanut butter, assuming we have no peanut allergies on the call today, but you get the idea. These are two things that go great together. So we want to dive into some of those specific patterns of how we see Cassandra and Kafka being used together. So I'll highlight two most frequently used patterns and then kind of tangentially mention a third maybe here in a second. The first one is in microservice architectures, especially where we see Cassandra and Kafka being used together. I've shown a pattern here in which we have a producer that is publishing data to a Kafka topic. And then there's a microservice there in the middle that's consuming data from that topic, and it could be one or more different topics. It might perform some kind of operation in which it actually needs to retrieve some data. Let's say it's retrieving some existing data from Cassandra. So it might consume data from some topics and then retrieve some other data from Cassandra, or it might be writing some data out to Cassandra. And then based on that, the whatever changed values that it's produced as a result of that operation on that microservice, it might also publish out some data with the results of its operation that it performed, and then maybe other consumers downstream. So this is an event-style architecture in which, it's more of an asynchronous approach in which Kafka is used to kind of orchestrate interactions between multiple services as data is flowing throughout the system. And then again, we're using Cassandra as potentially either a source or a sink of data in the application. And I know that example is a little bit abstract, so I wanted to make an example that is a little bit more concrete. We've actually done something like this in our killer video reference application, which we can share more links for that with you later on. But we have a situation that in which we're using Cassandra and Kafka together in our killer video application. And specifically, we have some services that are responsible for user management, adding new users to the system, video catalog when we're adding new videos to the system, and ratings when a user is rating a video that they've watched. So those services are using Cassandra as a store. They happen to be using Cassandra as a store for all of the video data and the user data and this rating data. But they also publish events to Kafka topics when a user is created, or a YouTube video is added, or a user rates a video. So we're using Kafka topics to distribute those messages, and we have a service that we've written called the Suggested Videos Service. It is a consumer of those three topics, and whenever a user is created, or a YouTube video is added, or a user rates a video, Suggested Videos Service is consuming events from Kafka and writing data into a graph database, which is provided by our DataStax Enterprise graph. So we're using Kafka as a message bus in this case between some of the different services in our application, and then writing data into a graph, which is then used to produce recommendations kind of further downstream in our application. So hopefully this is useful to you as a practical example of how we might combine Cassandra and Kafka together in a microservice application. The second pattern, which I'm going to show you, is the one that we're going to focus more on in this call today, which is using Cassandra as a backing store for, you know, one or more Kafka topics. So this is making use of the Kafka Connect framework, and specifically the DataStax Apache Kafka Connector. So the basic architecture of this, which we will then kind of peel the onion and dive into in more detail. Within this pattern, we have data sources that are writing data into topics in Kafka, and then that data is being consumed by the Kafka Connect framework, and specifically we have connectors within that framework, including the DataStax Apache Kafka connector, which is writing out to the DataStax as a backing store. There is a third possible pattern, which would be to take Cassandra data into Kafka, so kind of like an ETL type of pattern in which Cassandra data is being consumed in the Kafka. This is not something that our connector supports yet with Cassandra as a source, but we could see that being a capability at some point, and you could certainly write something like that yourself, potentially using, let's say, like the change data capture feature that's coming in Cassandra 4.0 and future versions of DataStax Enterprise. So that's a third pattern that's kind of on the horizon here. So at this point, I want to hand things over to Cedric to really dive into the details of the DataStax Kafka connector and a cool demonstration that he's going to provide to you.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Jeffrey. So now that you have a better understanding both of Apache Cassandra and Apache Kafka, let's see what we can do and how do you implement such a connector. So if I put all the system of records, even sources, on the left part of the screen and just draw Kafka, I just represented a topic, then stop it here. And on the other side, I just show DataStax Enterprise. And at the core of DataStax Enterprise, you see, of course, Apache Cassandra. Well, if you're already a DataStax Enterprise customer and is familiar with DataStax, you probably already know that we provided the search capacity using Apache Solar, the graph capacity using Gremlin, but also the Spark framework, which provides a wide number of connectors and tools. And in particular, there is already something called Spark Streaming, which is enabled to read something from Kafka and, of course, store the records into Cassandra. So first question is, what do you put a Kafka connector if you already provided something to move data from Kafka to Cassandra? Well, let's have a look. Okay. If you are using stock streaming, you basically pull the data from Kafka. You need to poll the topics, and you may be able to do some enrichment, transformation, complex algorithms, including tests and loops, and in the end, store everything into Apache Cassandra. But you need the third-party tools. You need some computation here and utility computations. So if Kafka itself would be able to push the data to Apache Cassandra, it would be better with no extra runtime, no extra performance overhead, and very much simpler. So this is the whole purpose of a connector here. We want Kafka to push the data to Apache Cassandra, doing some basic mapping, not real transformation, just moving the data. So if I look at the picture at the scene again now, on the Kafka stack, in the Kafka stack, we already spoken about Kafka Connect framework, which is a runtime inside Kafka platform, which provide a couple of components. We have the sources, which are able to get data from sources, even if they don't push, obviously, the data, like change data capture behavior. And we also provide, Kafka also provides things, data things, and this is what we need, and this is all about the Kafka connector here. Here it is. We will register a data sync in the Kafka platform to be able to store events on the DataStax Enterprise. Okay. So what is the Kafka connector? Well, it's a library deployed as a data sync in Kafka Connect that will get all the events from dedicated topics and push them on Cassandra table. It's simple, fast, flexible, and secure. It's based on the existing DataStax driver, Java driver, to connect to the platform. And it's pretty easy to deploy. We will see later during the demo. Kafka Connect provides a REST API, and we will just invoke this REST API to just instantiate the connector and make the messages flow up to Cassandra. At this old in Kafka Connect and the Kafka infrastructure, it will be automatically rebalancing and will improve, of course, the availability and scaling. There is no need for third-party tools as Spark now. As I said, this connector is built based on the driver, actually the new driver we released this year, including some reactive patterns. This is what we call best practice for writing CDC. It's full asynchronous, and it improves the resilience. Okay. So if I dig into the Kafka Connect framework and in the data sync, well, first, there is a property file to update just to say, hey, Kafka Connect, during your bootstrap, this is a list of class you should be aware, including the DataStax connector one, and then Kafka Connect will instantiate those classes. Once the classes have been instantiated, then it will read the configuration, the mapping, and go back, and the mapping just go back to the connector. And when the mapping is there, just it starts flowing the data from Kafka to Cassandra. Simple, isn't it? We'll start in a minute. So let's switch to demo mode. I will now share my screen, and I will ask some people to just validate that I'm able to you are able to see my screen. In a minute, maybe just one, two slides before. I've already downloaded the connector, and if you have to download it, please go to academy.datastax.com/download, as you probably already do for downloading all the DataStax products. Everything is there. There is no technical key, just download and you're able to use it. The connector is available for any version of DataStax Enterprise, from the 5.0 version, including the distribution of Apache Cassandra, DataStax distribution of Apache Cassandra, which is only Core Cassandra with the support of DataStax. I will do my demo using Docker. And just a reminder that DataStax provides all the images for you to run Cassandra in containers, including all the tools, the DataStax Enterprise, DataStax Studio, App Center. You will see that in a minute. And everything that I will do is available for you and GitHub. This is a link as a title, but soon we will also provide you all the reference for you to be able to reproduce the demo. Okay. As I will start a lot of containers, maybe it's a good time to just have a look at all the containers, and then I can switch to demo mode and share my screen. Okay. First, I have a producer. What I do, I will invoke an API on internet to get stock valuation from a public API called Alpha Vantage. And from that, I will generate some events and push those events into the Kafka stack. And in the Kafka stack, we got Apache Zookeeper, which is required to ensure consistency in the Kafka world. Kafka itself, okay, of course, pushing events into Kafka like that. On the DataStax stack, I will have DataStax Enterprise, DataStax Studio, and App Center. And then, once everything is started, I will start Kafka Connect. Register the connector in Kafka Connect and see if we can make message coming into DataStax Enterprise. Okay, let's switch now. Okay, it's coming. Okay. Jess, can you tell if you can see my screen now? It took a bit of time, but it should be ready now.
Hey, Cedric, this is Mike. Yes, we can see your screen now.
Okay, yeah, I don't know contact. Sorry about that. So let's move on.
No worries.
So as I said, everything is available on Docker. So what I did, I created a Docker compose file, and I just declare some Zookeeper, Kafka, DataStax Enterprise, DataStax Studio, and UpCenter. And a little bit of Kafka HQ we'll see in a minute. So I run the command. I already did that before. It took a bit of time to start. And from now, if I open a browser, well, I have the UpCenter running. That's showing me my cluster. This is a test cluster with a single data center, DC1. And we can see that search, Spark, and graph are available on those nodes. And I can see all the metrics on my cluster to see if I get some requests. And I can also see which are the services enabled on my cluster. So pretty simple, just a basic container to start. Then I have DataStax Studio, which is a web-based tool providing some notebooks. So I can open the connection and see if these notebooks can connect to DataStax Enterprise. It can. And I can then open a notebook. And see that in the notebook, we can create some markdown, SQL statements, and even Gremlin and Spark SQL statements. Well, last but not least, I also have that small tool named Kafka HQ, which is a web-based tool, totally free as well, available as a Docker container, which can allow me to browse my topic and see what's happening inside Kafka. So now, if I go back to my IDE and start the producer, the injector, it will start, connect to the Alpha Vantage API, create the key space and table if I need to get those items. And from now, it will start to push events into Kafka. First, I can go to the studio and see if the tables, notebooks, key space have been created. So I can go to my connection, SQL, pick the demo Kafka system and see that my tables have been created. I can also run a SQL statement to see if my tables are there. Okay. The injector has also populated the table with some stock name, and from there, it will fetch some information from Alpha Vantage using those codes. If I look at Kafka and refresh, now there is a new topic, subtopics, of course. And if I dig into this topic, I can see that I got some messages going on. So it's JSON messages. In the Kafka world, you can send messages in different natures, could be binary and ASCII format, could be JSON, could be text, could be Kafka struct. The Kafka connector will support all those patterns, but here I chose just JSON. And okay, now if I go to the studio, note shipping, my table is there, but is empty. Events only flows up to Kafka. Now I will start Kafka Connect. can go to Stax Kafka Connect. I will also use Docker, another Docker Compose. So I go to Kafka Connect here. I put that in bigger. And Kafka Connect needs a lot of environment variables, including the Kafka server, of course, the port to expose the API, the converter. You can see that I use a JSON, and that's it. Nothing else. Keys are string, values are JSON. I do not enable the schema validation. And I include in a volume, why, to be able to load the DataStax Connector library, JAR, into the class path of Kafka Connect. And you can see that. Just use something in this folder and make it available in the JAR. And once the Kafka Connect will have been started, then I will have a bash command, which will execute a HTTP POST request to register my connector and to set up my connector in Kafka Connect. It's not only having the class available on the class path is not enough. I need to set up the configuration and mapping. So if I look here, I will say, oh, all the stock topic, please connect to DSE, which is the host name of DataStax Enterprise, on the data center DC1 using port 9042. There is a lot of settings to enable authentication, SSL, and the most interesting part is in the end. It's all about the mapping. So mapping is quite simple. Just build some keys. Let's say topic.topic, which is the name of the topic, need to map to demo Kafka, which is a key space name, stockfix, which is a table name, and the mapping. And mapping from JSON to Cassandra table is also very easy. Symbol should go to, this is symbol is the name of the column in Cassandra table, should map to JSON, and in the JSON value, get symbol, which is at first level of the JSON. Same for value, value.value, right? Okay. What a nice mapping. And value date is value.value date, simple like that. I can also change the consistency when I write data to Cassandra. You know that Cassandra has tunable consistency, and if you need more consistency, you can update these two columns, up to each column as you need. You would like to avoid using tombstones and do not insert null in columns that they don't need to have null. Just use unset and just use as less of tombstones as you can. And extra keys to help you mapping from dates, from JSON to Cassandra. And from then, let's execute this Docker compose. So now, if you look at the command line, there is no dash D. So we will see in the console what will happen. So Kafka Connect starting. And we are waiting for the REST API to be ready. Okay, it's done. Now we are loading the class path. And Kafka Connect is loading classes. So we found some things for HDFS, things for GMS, things for MQ, Elasticsearch. It's all provided by default by the Kafka framework. But we also added our own jar for DSE sync connector. And we will see in a minute that it has also been detected. And we will just then okay, now it has been both detected, and we also create, push the settings, use the HTTP post up to the connector. So So now, if I go to DataStax Studio and try to display what's in my tables, now we can see that we got some information. Okay, there is already a lot. No cheating. I will truncate my tables and do it again. So events are flowing, they are coming. So now the connector is enabled and events are flowing up to Cassandra. Last but not least, I would like to show you what we can do using the new Java driver, also provided by DataStax this year, simple web UI about what we can achieve. So let's connect here. So this is the web UI. I just select everything from my first table stock info. Again, no cheating, let's truncate my tables. And pick one of the values, let's say Boeing for today. And look at that. Each time there is a new event in my Cassandra table, I will get notified using the reactive driver, and I can draw in real time thickness curve. So all the events are just flowing from my injector to Kafka and then up to Cassandra, and my driver can also be used to fetch all the info. I will now stop sharing my screen, go back to the slide, and show you and let it sink to death.
All right. So thank you, Cedric, for the demonstration there. Hopefully that gives a little bit of a sense of how easy it is to set up and configure and get this running. And I would like to provide this resource to you. You can run this same demonstration that Cedric has been running. It's available for you to download if you go to Cedric's GitHub. That's that fourth link there in the list on this slide under demonstration, that Kafka-DSE repo that he has. CLUN is Cedric's GitHub handle. So you can go there and check out this demo and run it yourself using Docker in your own environment. We wanted to provide you with some other links as well. There's a great blog post from Chris Splinter, our colleague. He's a product manager who is in charge of the Kafka connector, among other things. So he's written a great blog post about kind of an overview of the capabilities and compatibility and what versions this works with, et cetera. That's a great resource to get started. You can also go to the academy.datastax.com. You can download the connector from DataStax Academy. Our documentation site, we provide a link there for you as well. And then finally, there are also some other examples on GitHub that you can use. That's under the DataStax organization on GitHub, and there's a Kafka examples repo that you can look at with several other source code examples. I'll also mention that there is a short course on DataStax Academy called the Kafka Connector Getting Started course that you can find there on Academy. So that is something that you can go through in about 20 minutes and get a great introduction. And again, seeing the configuration of the connector in action. So highly recommend that high quality free training content on Academy, along with all of our other courses that we have on there. Another thing I will mention is the advocate team here at DataStax, so the team that Cedric and I are on. We have started doing live coding, which we're streaming on the Twitch platform, and we frequently do offer these a couple of times a week we're on there doing live coding on something or other. So one of the recent episodes that we had was actually featuring Cedric and Alex Solochnev, or another developer advocate on our team, and they were doing some of this same live coding on the connector in this example code. You can actually go to that YouTube link and rewatch. We posted that online, so you can watch them. And you might want to just follow us on Twitch if you're interested in this new phenomenon of watching people code, which is actually a great way to learn, kind of looking over the shoulder of a great developer. And I will tell you that Cedric is a great developer. So I would love to do that all the time. Next week, if you are in the eastern part of the United States or able to get to the eastern part of the United States, next week we are having our DataStax Accelerate conference. So this is certainly the biggest and best Cassandra-themed conference that's been there in several years since we last had a Cassandra Summit in 2016. So it's been a long time, but we're super excited, just kind of jumping out of our chairs, excited to get together with the community, with our people, next week in the Washington, D.C. area. And specifically, I went through the agenda, and there's at least four talks that are referencing Kafka in some way or fashion, including the talk that I'm giving. But these two talks that I've highlighted here in particular are very focused on Kafka and Cassandra together. So Cliff Gilmore from Confluent will be giving a talk covering a lot of these kind of same themes of architectural patterns that I talked about today, just in a little bit more depth. And then there's also a talk that is focused on an OSS community effort on open source Cassandra to stream data from Cassandra into Kafka. And I know that some of you were asking about that in the Q&A. So this is a great talk to see how Andrew and Abrar from Yelp have accomplished this on the open source version. All right, so with that, that's all the content that we have for today, but Michael may have some questions for us. I see that there might have been a few of those that have popped up.
Thank you, guys. Yes, we do have several questions that have come in throughout the presentation. So I'll go ahead and ask you guys those now, if you guys don't mind. We have about 5 minutes left, so we'll answer as many as we can. First one here, does Kafka Connector also provide a way to process record before dumping into Cassandra?
Okay, so I will take this one. So the connector itself will only do some mappings, so simple mappings, no transformation. But Jeffrey told us about KSQL, Kafka stream, also available in the Kafka stack. You create a stream. You will do some transformation inside the Kafka stream, and then the Kafka stream will be perceived as a topic. So use the connector to map the result topics into Cassandra tables. So when to choose between KSQL and batch streaming? Well, if you are able to put all the data in the Kafka platform using sources, maybe Kafka is the best place to do it. But even with KSQL, it's simple transformations. Arithmetic, concatenation, mints, and so forth and so on. But if you need enrichment and advanced algorithm, then switch to Spark training.
Great. Thank you, Cedric. Another one here. Am I right to infer that Kafka Connector is available and only works with DSE, or will it work with Apache Cassandra as well?
Well, as the Kafka connector using the enterprise drivers, it will be available only for DataStax solutions. Not only the DataStax enterprise full-fledged, but also the core Cassandra distribution of, you know, DataStax distribution of Apache Cassandra, but not OSS Cassandra.
Okay, great. Another one here, will there be an option in Cassandra to trigger the CURD operations as messages to Kafka stream? I saw that Jeff answered it, but I just thought it'd be good for everybody to hear.
Sure. Okay. So, yes, I think there is a way of accomplishing, once we get Cassandra 4.0, really the best way to do that would be through the change data capture feature that's coming out in that. There is also a trigger mechanism that you can implement in Cassandra. So there are a couple of people that have implemented solutions that leverage that trigger mechanism to do a CDC-like capability. And I'm guessing I don't know the details of that Yelp talk at Accelerate that I just mentioned, but I imagine that that's probably the technique that they use. I mean, that's a guess on my part, but probably using triggers.
Okay, great. Thank you, Jeff. It looks like the other questions are more around the links and getting the slides. So everybody will receive the links to GitHub as well as the on-demand recording to this presentation in the next 24 hours. So look out for that as well. But other than that, it looks like we should be all set. If you have any other questions, please send them in. We will make sure to get those answered. Thank everybody for their time today. I really appreciate it. Great job by Cedric and Jeff. And as Jeff mentioned, if you're on the East Coast, come by next week to DataStax Accelerate and check us out there. We'll have some great presentations, great talks from some of the leading experts on Apache Cassandra. So thanks, everybody, and have a great day.